howdy do, folks. What's happening out there in computer world and Facebook land? I'm going to wait for a few people to jump on here before I get this thing rolling. I'm going to do a quickly share with my group here. One thing about groups while I'm getting set up, and if anybody listens in the future, be aware of the groups you join on Facebook, because many groups are sway groups. They will sway your opinion to a different side of the picture that you're involved in. Something like you're really interested in, you know, and you'll all of a sudden get turned around and you had no idea how you got turned around. I'm just adjusting some microphone settings here. Give you a little more head. Let's see. Logitech. Boom, boom. Chickity boom. Can you hear me louder now? Is it louder, louder? Should be a little bit louder. Should be a little better. Anyhow. Okay. I have so many windows open, as you can see on the screen. I just wanted to start by explaining paradigms. Paradigm, basically, what we're talking about. I'm going to highlight this, make a little chalkboard here. By the way, if you want to do stuff for school, if you're a teacher, the software I'm using is called OBS software. It's a free open source software. It's great for school. You know, if you're in school and you want to show students stuff, this is a great way to do this. If you're not in the class, some classes are online. Some classes that you go to in college, like your Friday class, is optional to go. You can actually go stay at home and do it. So we're talking about a paradigm, and we're talking about natural science. We're talking about the collapse of Florida ecosystems. Now, a typical example of a paradigm is something of a model. You know, there's a model that you create, a model for a society, a model for an aquarium, a model toy, whatever. Linguistics will be affected by paradigms. And can form an exact paradigm, because linguistics will alter the course of history. For example, in some cultures, they don't have pronouns. They think of themselves as we, as a community, as a social order. So they have no pronoun. Anyway, so and basically, just to give you the idea, the paradigm idea is that we're going through a shift right now. Paradigm science and natural science, or normal science, are two different things, according to Kuhn especially. Thomas Kuhn is a professor, and I have a book right here. Sorry, I don't have my cameras working right now. My stupid webcam, I have like a portable, it broke. I could probably get it going, but it's real. I have one that's such low resolution, and there's so much crap on the screen. It's not even worth seeing my ugly mug right now, but I'm here. I'm behind the camera, behind the screen, behind the thing here. Let me show you up on the screen. If you'll look up on the right corner, I'm going to go ahead and highlight some stuff for you. Okay. Watch this. Let's see. Color source, boom, and text, boom. Now, up here, if you take a look at so much stuff going on, this is my chalkboard. What I'm trying to get to is this right here. Oop. Okay, where is it? If sick, man. Oh, here, you know what I'll do? I'm not using my head, because I wanted to show you the basic ecosystems that we're dealing with right now. We have to maintain each one, right? And if one of them is out of whack, there's a problem with the entire scope of them, okay? So, for example, you know about coral. You know how delicate corals are. We have corals in Florida. The stuff that I'm talking about today comes from a book called The Structure of Scientific Revolutions by Thomas Kuhn. This is the second edition enlarged. I have up on the screen right here. Where do I have it? I have his PDF. You can actually, if you wanted to get the PDF, it's just have to type in the title of the book, which is Structure of Scientific Revolutions, and Thomas Kuhn, and you could read this for yourself. I can drop this down in the what you call it here. I will do that right now for you, get you the link, and I'm not going to rush through this. It's going to take a few minutes. I'm not going to make this ridiculously long to bog you down with nonsense. But this is some of the most important stuff you're going to find out that nobody told you about. It's just that simple. This stuff is not what people are telling you about. And that's where this stuff really comes in handy, because this is what it is all about. So if you don't know what's going on, you're going to be fighting battles that come from an emotional state, because we all care about our ecosystems. We all care about all of the things in society. Give you a little background on myself. I'm a marine biologist. I'm a bunch of things, but one of my things that gives me credibility in science, or gives me understanding of science, I studied marine biology. I graduated from Long Island University, Southampton College, private university, private college, private part of the Long Island University College, out in Southampton, New York. I came to Florida to work at Moat Marine Lab. I worked there for 2 years in creating habitats and creating an environment for a fish farm and for studies within that fish farm on different species, for regenerating the species that's being depleted by the temperature changes and environment changes and things like that. And I'm going to talk about global warming and stuff, what this is all about. I personally, just on a side note real quick, have seen the warming. Of course I have. I've seen, in a way I can explain it to you, is in snook population. A snook is a fish we have here in Florida. And I'm going to just show you a picture of it real quick. The snook was affected intensely by temperature changes, because the temperature changes the snook can undergo, it can't handle, its brain can't handle the temperature changes. It doesn't have the ability for maybe a 4 degree change above or below its comfortable zone. So, and this fish is a crucial fish to many, many ecosystems. It is a very prolific fish, which means it's widespread around the world, especially. This is a widespread fish. They call it different things in different parts of the world, but it's mainly in the perch family. So here's your perch, which is one of your base fish in the food, in the fish cycle. So the snook that I studied and grew at Moat, when I grew these fish, they're quite large and they're quite fun to catch. They are endangered right now by more than just like pollution, but temperature changes. People used to think they were endangered by fishing overfishing. And that's not the case. It might have been a case at one time when regulations weren't in place for specific harvesting. The fish this gentleman's holding in his hands right there is too big for harvesting, meaning that that fish has now changed into a female. Yes, these fish change into females at a certain size and a certain age, and they will be able to balance their own environment, their own ecosystem. In terms of their survival, to be able to, what we used to do as Moat Marine scientists was we'd go out, we'd net these fish, gently net them, and we'd get in the water with them, put them in baby pens, and we would actually get the eggs, and we get the milt from the males, the sperm, and we would inoculate eggs. We'd do our own laboratory test tube baby snook. And we were basically very successful at raising these fish. Now, this was a very great endeavor that snook, that Moat Marine Lab undertook. But also now, I want to tell you just on a side note while I'm talking about that, Moat Marine Lab also undertook something about red tide. They took a lot of money from people, and I hate to talk poorly about people that I loved and worked for, but at Moat Marine Lab, they took money for red tide when I know everybody there is studying algae. They already know about algae. They know what would have caused it. It wasn't your phosphorus. It wasn't your sugars. It wasn't your different companies, corporations, and things around town primarily. It might have caused some of it. This is your primary monster that did it. Iron fertilization. It is the intentional introduction. That's a lot of I's. Here, ready? Iron fertilization is the intentional introduction of iron to iron poor areas of the ocean surface to stimulate phytoplankton production. It makes plankton. When the earth was one time anaerobic and basically was covered in plant life, and CO2 was the most proliferate gas in the environment that we could breathe, that the creatures on the earth could breathe, not us, we weren't here, but that the plants could breathe was CO2. And so there was a lot of plants that, well, you know what I mean. The plants breathe CO2, they ingest CO2, plant life does. And phytoplankton is part plant and part animal. It's a little bit of half and half, and basically, in so many words, just to make it not so boring and scientific. There's different types of plankton. Okay, there's zooplankton, which can consist of things like squid in their what you call it, stay in their when squid are very small, when they're in their larval state. I can't think right now. There's so much I'm thinking about, and now I'm sidetracking a little. But these things are important to know about, that plankton and planktonic creatures cover a wide range of creatures. So we should get our vocabulary straight when we're talking about red tide, because what we think about red tide is we're looking at red tide as a corporate problem. That's not necessarily the case here, as you can see. When iron fertilization is the intentional introduction of iron to iron-poor areas of the ocean surface to stimulate phytoplankton production. The reason why that area is iron-poor, it's a purposeful thing by Earth. Do you understand? The Earth makes that area called the pelagic zone, which is the zone of the ocean where it's very, or it's open. The open areas of the ocean out here that shouldn't have any kind of green life do. See, this is blue and green. This is different types of algae. We always think of red tide as red. Not necessarily the case. There's so many different types of algae that cause different things. See, this is an oceanic phytoplankton bloom in South Atlantic Ocean off the coast of Argentina, covering an area about 50 miles by 300 miles. Now, that's large, isn't it, folks? Now, when you talk about, oh, my phosphorus mine caused an algae bloom, do you think it's 500 or 300 miles by 50 miles, which is 15,000 square miles. That's a lot of square miles. is my math right? 15,000 square miles. Wow, I suck at math. That's one of the bad things about my science. Anyway, here's something that Wikipedia will show you, because CO2, and this is all going to tie in. I'm not jumping around. This is all an inclusive thing. CO2 is part of the new carbon capture money-making experience that these people are using a societal shift in science as an excuse for. So they're telling you you need a better science when you don't. But they are business people, not necessarily people with your best interests. The scientists that have your best interests at heart are squelched. They're not heard from. You're never hearing from them. You're hearing from these monsters because they're part of a bigger corporate consumption thing. Remember Pac-Man, the game Pac-Man? Anyway, all video, just a side note, video games are all made originally by the military for purposes that are vast, partly of brain training the brain to condition a certain response pattern. But also, wasn't Pac-Man a consumer? This image just made me think of Pac-Man, the consumer. He consumes and consumes. Anyway, the idea is that we're going to be consuming so much, and our offput of CO2, our footprint or whatever, is now the big money maker. Do you understand? So they need to have problems in environment, don't they, if they're going to be making money off it? And they is not concerned scientists. They is people using science that's used by concerned human beings to change things for the better. Prime example, would you rather have your head drilled for a headache or take an aspirin? Pause. You notice that pause there? Would you rather have your head drilled or have an aspirin? That was a paradigm shift. That was a scientific revolution. A lot of people lost their jobs when they had to put their drill down. Or maybe they became picture hangers. You know, or builders. So they use the drill for building or dentistry. But they stop drilling heads. Anyway, CO2 is being captured by these so-called scientists with interest. They don't have interest except in their own pockets. And what happens now with this whole, why fertilization? Why am I talking about this? Well, ocean iron fertilization, the plankton, captures CO2. It is not a reasonable resource. This is going to see how this ties in. It's not a reasonable resource. It doesn't do well capturing CO2, because what happens in a plankton bloom is it over proliferates. It overdoes it. Okay. So let's look at a plankton. Plankton. Oops. Oh, plankton. Oh, plankton. Am I doing like Shakespeare? Plankton bloom. See, now when you search things, using correct terminology is very helpful. Over proliferation. Okay, images. Let's go to images. Are a good way to get to another source, because then, you know, they'll tell you at the bottom a little thing here, World Oceans Day. This will get you, obviously, an article to World Oceans Day. See what I'm saying? This is a good way to search things quickly using, like, a quick... sorry for banging the mic. This is using the way to get this done quick. Now, what you can do is you can look at all of the different aspects of over-proliferation of plankton bloom. Lake Okeechobee, look at that, number two. I mean, of course, I'm in Florida, so it knows where my location is. That's why it's on there. There's a lot, toxic algae, zooplankton, green algae, algae bloom. Let's look at a basic algae bloom. I'm trying to find a diagram. Okay, so in a basic algae diagram, a bloom, what happens is you get the bloom, right? And this top layer is getting all the benefit of the sunshine, because, like, it's a plant, so it gets the benefits of the photosynthesis up here. But guess what happens to this? This stuff that's supposed to be capturing your CO2 is also killing off this bottom layer by blocking out the sunlight. The more this top layer grows, the less the middle layer grows. Now, what do you think the bottom layer is doing? That's just having a really hard time, and that stuff dies off very quickly. So all that lives is this top layer here, and it dies off as fast as it grows, not collecting much CO2. You can see here's an unhealthy cycle. Warmer water enhanced with blooms. Thicker blooms develop. Dark algae absorbs heat, thusly creating warmer water. Darker creating warmer. These are good ways to dig through science a little bit, but to understand that when they're creating an algae bloom, that they know by scientific research in the by normal science, natural science, not even paradigm science, which is science that's so strange and so bizarre you don't recognize it. Literally, it's going to be something so new you don't even know what it is. But this stuff right here, what we're talking about with the algae bloom and the red tide, they're creating with ocean iron fertilization. They're creating with this process right here, where they're dumping iron. See, look, here's your image of what they're doing in the Southern Ocean. And don't get me wrong, all the oceans are connected. The trick that they're doing is they're dumping ocean iron fines, which is waste from factories, into the ocean. That speeds up algae blooms. Now, the algae dies, right? It goes to the bottom of the ocean. And I'm going to show you something. Well, you would say, you know, isn't this great that they're going to use a natural source of a plant life or algae or life on the earth to cool the earth? Well, let me show you what happens. Scientists... Hold on, science. Bear with me. This is all really good. Scientists discover how to speed up the bio from So what they've done over, and see, I spell things terribly. here you go, first article. Okay, engineers develop a fast method to convert algae to biofuel. What do you know about them apples? So really, the entire idea of dropping the iron fines into the ocean that they tell you is to cool the planet is really these people in the background. They have developed a way to make fuel out of that bioorganism that they were supposed to cool your planet with that doesn't work at all. So you see where their motives are, okay? This is what I'm saying. This is where their motives lie. It's in fuel production for a new world of sustainability. I'm putting quotes with my fingers. You can hear it in my voice. Sustainability, which is part of an ancient agenda on getting people to be more austere, to live more... Literally without, I'm not talking, okay, maybe we only have one car. I'm talking no car. And if you need a bike, you're in trouble. You've got to take public transportation. Everything in Agenda 21 is not conspiracy or theory. It's all there, written in black and white. Nobody's hiding any of it. So to know that they're using algae as fuel and to know that that's why they're dumping it in the ocean. Now, we just settled your problem or our problem with red tide in terms of where it's coming from. We know that they are plankton overbloom population. I mean, they're blooming this on purpose. They're blooming this on purpose, the algae, to create a way to capture CO2, insofar as they're telling the public. Whoever gets to find out they're doing it, that's who they tell. In the meantime, they throw a dartboard in the air for red tide and let you try to figure it out. They don't want you to know. They don't want you to know where the algae is coming from, per se. They're not going to tell you. They throw a dartboard into a dark room. They send you and 10 friends who have had about 3 or 4 beers in there and say, go ahead and play darts with the lights out. You know you're going to hear some screams. Nobody's going to hit the bullseye. But somebody might get the board. They might get close. Okay, there is problems with, there is problems with your phosphorus. Yes, those things are fertilizers. Sure, they do produce algae blooms. Yes, those things can be managed, can they not? Why are they not being managed? Why? Because they need to create a crisis in order to get us all on board. Let me take you someplace else. In the meantime, I want to show you something right here. What a paradigm shift is all about. I'm going to jump around because all of it is part of the other, okay? Kuhn asserts in a paradigm shift. See, now what I'm looking at here is a little model of our mangrove forest here in Florida, which is totally decimated and barely working anymore. And it's due to many things. Now, we don't have exotic species on the planet. There is no such thing as exotic species. Creatures move about the earth. The species is only exotic for the time in which we deem it exotic. Because if we weren't here, that species would move around just like we do. There's no exotic. There's migration of things. You dig? So in terms of what we want to deem exotic, that's a governmental push for some agenda. We got to get people on board by telling them an invader has come. See? An invader. So now here's the true invader, okay? The true invader is the paradigm shifter, okay? This is the scientist, which is all from here, Thomas Kuhn. I'm not going to read out of the book because I don't want to bore the crap out of you. But the idea is if you look at some of the beginning parts of this, what he talks about in this experience, and I'm just going to show you the model because I can explain it to you without boring you. You understand? Because if I read it to you, it's a little bit heady and boring. But here, there's paradigm shift. Okay, this and you've probably seen shows, Paradigm Shift. They're getting you ready. They want you to know about it. And they want the people who are involved in it to say, hey, look, you know, you're right. You're right on top. A good idea of what a paradigm shift is, either drilling your head or having an aspirin. That shifted the entire scientific structure. That was a revolution. Ptolemy, if you look on the screen here, Ptolemy, who thought that that the Earth was the center of the revolution of our universe, right, of our galaxy, whereas Nicholas Copernicus realized that the Earth was not the center, and he realized that it was the sun rather than the Earth that was at the center of the universe. Now, that got people burnt at stakes and such, and of course, that was very big science. That changed an entire scope of science, didn't it? That entire experience of having a new scientific shift. Well, you know, now no longer is the Earth the center, the sun is. So here's what happens. Paradigm shift is up here. Right now we're in a paradigm science shift. The normal science that we were in came from a prior paradigm. So we look at a tree. We know how a tree works. We know the tree's green. We know all the parts of the tree, right? Most of us, even on the most basic level, understand a tree. So that was at one time a paradigm because before we knew what a tree was, it was just another thing in the forest. Like when we were more primitive and just using it for wood, for fire or building, we weren't really sure what the scientific nature was of a tree. So we might have called it brother or something like that, right? Hugging trees, whatever. So that was the paradigm shift to normal science when we learned what the tree was by dissecting it, by doing studies that we didn't have tools for. So according to Kuhn, like the tools will lose their meaning. If you have a new dental practice, you're a new style of dentistry, the old tools might not be needed anymore. You need maybe now a UV light to cure the amalgams, or not the amalgam anymore, but now that you're using composites in your diced salt dental supplies. Then now they use like a composite that doesn't have mercury. Before it was amalgam that they used to let set on its own, whereas now it's a composite that uses a UV light when they blast in your mouth, and that cures the product. So that's paradigm shift in a dentistry. See, or let's say more than paradigm shift, that's revolutionary science. It put away the old science. It made it look archaic. Made it look something out of the dark ages. So the model drift. Now all of a sudden, with normal science, we mess around. We mess around with normal science, right? We play with it. That's not we, but they do. They mess around with our society. They build it. They create it. They shut it down. They break it. But they mess around with the model of the science. So they take, for example, right here is a model. They take the model of the mangroves and they mess with it. Somewhere along the line, there's a committee that maybe doesn't know the other committee's trying to save it. They're doing something that's destroying it, but they don't really understand what they're doing. Everybody's hired for their job specifically, and they're compartmentalized, marginalized, they're put into catalog. Everybody gets their own section. Don't leak out into the other sections. Stay where you are, or you lose your job, you lose your money. And we know how hard it is to live anymore. So the harder it is for us to live, the more we depend upon believing or buying bullshit to basically make a dollar to survive. But see, my paradigm, I'm shifting that with my soap. And thank you, by the way, if you purchase my soap. I'm doing it all healthy. Everything healthy in my soap. Everything. Anyway, not to get on a commercial, but model crisis. Now, we got to put our model in crisis. So all of a sudden, now we look at our mangroves. Our mangroves are, where are they? Our mangroves, where's my cursor? Our mangroves are suffering, aren't they, in Florida? We're having a problem with temperature rises in Florida. The back bays are getting hotter. The water is getting darker, and I could tell you why. Excuse me. I have chemtrail cough. I don't smoke cigarettes. The water in the back bays, as I've noticed throughout I've been alive for 40 something years, and I've been coming to this part of Florida forever. And when I started coming here to work here, it was even more in depth of a scientific study in and out of the water. I've seen it from the bottom to the top. I was a diver. I'd love to be in the water. I spent all my days in the water up in New York as well down here. I surfed. I lived in the ocean. Anybody in my family could tell you that you could see my pictures. I've been fishing since I was born. Literally came out with a silver spoon in my mouth. Get it? A spoon? Fishing spoon? Anyway, so the idea is that I've noticed the changes. I've seen the fish die off. I've seen less and less and less, and I've seen more regulations on food. Fishing. I've seen more regulations employed, but more stuff's dying. What's happening? Well, under paradigm science, they could do anything they want with a crisis. They could kill off all the trees, all the snook, all the fish, everything. Kill it off completely. No problem. That's okay, according to Kuhn's paradigm science shift. Revolutionary science is supposed to take away the drilling of the head. You know, the normal science of the day was drilling a head to get rid of the evil spirits to make your headache go away. Then revolutionary science came in because there was a crisis. We noticed that more people were just dying from holes in their heads than they were from migraines. So they decided to give them aspirin. You know what I'm saying? That's really important to understand why our environment is being corrupted right now so badly. They've got... For example, Mars has been on the horizon, literally, since the 19? Mars has been on the horizon since the ancient Greeks, ancient Romans. This has always been a thing. They've always looked to Mars. Something about Mars, I'm not going to get into that part, but there's something about Mars. I talked about this in my last talk. India, rather than spending the money they have on their corrupted infrastructure, broken infrastructure, not corrupted, well, corrupted and broken infrastructure, they spent the money on their Mars project. Why would they do that? Well, the prime minister or president, whatever, said that we need to do this because we need to be on the global map. In a world of globalist uprising right now. What's happening, there's another revolution happening, and that's also political. But remember, political is a science. Politics is a science. Our entire world is a science. It's basically broken down to the maths and the sciences. But in essence, they can be corrupted. They're not always infallible, and they're not always led by nice people. But what, take a breath. What I'm trying to say is that through the model revolution of this paradigm shift up here, model revolution, model crisis, and model revolution. Right now, they're spraying skies. They're tearing down rainforests. Here's the revolution that they're putting in now. Plastic trees. Have you heard about this? Well, we'll find an article while I talk. Plastic trees from Harvard. They're doing green lawns. Okay, these lawns from Harvard, what they're trying to accomplish. Plastic here. All you have to do is type these things in sometimes as you think them. Plastic lawns from Harvard. And now let's go scholarly papers. Well, let's just do a regular Google search, okay? Regular Google search for plastic lawns from Harvard. Oh boy. Now I got to tell you, I have a neighbor in town here with a plastic grass. He's got plastic lawn on his thing. So this is Harvard's when grass isn't greener. They're telling you to put down plastic turf in this article. Okay, and this is what's happening. I've seen it. My neighbor has it. My neighbor has this on his thing, on his lawn. Now, is my neighbor doing something good for the planet? No. He's removed the lawn that was there prior, taking up CO2, taking up all the gases that are actually harmful to the planet, and he put plastic grass here in Florida. It looks like a golf course, a mini golf course. It's horrible. It looks ridiculous. And he says, oh, I'm being very green. And I says, oh my God. I says, you bought the ticket, didn't you? You bought the ride. You went on the ride. So listen to me. So understanding this is all getting, I don't want to get too far away from, too deep into one or two different things, except for the main topic of Florida's ecosystem and the scientific revolution. People are using a scientific revolution that we need a better science to do things to the planet that will classify them in 50 years as the new moguls. I'm not kidding. This is really about business models. Harvard green business models. Let's take the pictures because it's a lot easier. Now, I just want to look. Let me do a fast scroll. Watch the screen. It doesn't end, does it? Look. They have every intention of making money off this green movement, folks. The same people who are spraying the skies, Harvard, Royal Society, Oxford, working on our personalities, working on our behaviors. Oxford, MIT are very scientific universities, but they're very, very much involved in the science of social science. So developing societies is their gig. I want to just show you, you can look, you go on Facebook. It's my mom. I have to take that later. I'm in the middle of a class, Mom. Zuckerberg is a horrible man, bought up most of Hawaii. You know, Facebook, there's a lot going on that we are unaware of that directly ties into things. People say, don't these people have families? Don't they worry about what they're doing to the environment? They can live within the smaller ecosystem, folks. They can live in Hawaii. They can live in a different ecosystem where we're not going to be. Prime example, Agenda 21, Florida. Agenda, oh boy, 21, Florida. This is going to make your butt pucker a little bit because the Agenda 21 Florida deal is that Florida is supposed to be a super city for Agenda 21's principal policy. And I'm not laughing at this. I'm laughing because it's madness. Literally, it is truly like something out of Dr. Evil or like a James Bond flick, which is all programming us for when this was supposed to happen, ironically. Now, when you're talking about sustaining an environment, and they're telling you that they're going to put everyone into Florida, they're talking, I'm not kidding, you can look this up, I just pulled up the pictures so that you can see that there is completely, there's completely an entire world of Florida, and here's the Agenda 21 maps and people fighting it. There's endless Agenda 21 experience, okay? And what they're doing with Florida, I want you to think about Florida. This is the California one. The Florida thing is about Florida is a peninsula. Florida is a very controllable zone from all angles, isn't it? If you have a border at the edge of Florida, border guards, like you do now going into Georgia, you get arrested there, or you get pulled over and searched. Whether you have weed in your car or not, they're going to pull you over. It happened to me. I was on the road for 3.5 hours when they searched my brand new car. They took apart everything in my car. They wanted to cut my surfboard in half. They never found anything. It was ridiculous. So this is what happens. And they're getting you prepped for the police state back then. This was back in the 90s. Now this is years later. They probably do the same thing. And even though it's legal. So, you know, weed's legal. But, of course, you see what's happening in the world. And you understand that the UN is in charge of everything. And, you know, you see all this politics. It's all wrestling. It's not real. I'm not going to get on that right now. But that's not real. It's all wrestling. And it's to kind of get people's personal acceptance of things. Like, they got to get the country all involved. Oh yes, we want to fight this too, because they have to drive your emotional levels up so that you get involved. Otherwise, you're not involved. Prime example, Red Tide in St. Armand Circle pissed off every single business owner. And if I go here, St. Armand's and Red Tide beach conditions, red tide unravel, travel alerts, visit Sarasota, decorations, red tide, Sarasota. I mean, I'm telling you, it's everywhere. I confronted, I think it was Barakovich or one of those ecologist people who I thought was a hero of mine. And it turned out that she was too interested in selling water filters rather than answering my questions about red tide and ocean iron fertilization, which is killing our environment. What is heating up the water in Florida? Well, when they build, they do a lot of deforesting, detreeing. You know, they fell trees a lot. And a lot of the tree stuff, a lot of that falls into the water. A lot of it gets put out as mulch. And a lot of that mulch goes back into the water. And that increases tannic acid in the back bays. Back bays, when they're very shallow, are fairly not saline, they don't have a high salinity, so they're the sweet water, and they get very dark, and they can absorb a lot of heat. Also, on the bottom of the water out there, you get different types of algae that grow or grow more because of certain conditions. And yes, fertilizer from your lawns has everything to do with it, but we're not fertilizing our lawns like the golf courses are. So golf courses are more a problem than Joe, you know, Schmo in town. You and I are not doing the problem with our Toyota. They're doing it with factories on the bigger scales, which are not going to be shut down under Agenda 21. Only you and I. Only you and I are going to be put into the state of what you call it, of complete austerity, where we're not going to have access to these beaches as the Florida super city under the UN. We're not going to have access to nature. Because according to the crisis and emergence of scientific theories part, there's a response. And this is in Kuhn's book. And so in the scientific world, now the response coming to the crisis is you get off the land, folks. And so what they're using all of these scientific means to basically push everybody off of land, okay? And I know, let me check my page, because I don't know if anybody's even has a question or anything. I'm not looking at the main post at all. But somebody, oh, here you are, perception. Okay, yes, it is all perception. Treatment or bioremediation. Oh, yeah, okay, exactly. Tammy, yeah, I'm sorry, I wasn't looking at the main post because I'm so focused on the other stuff, and I get off to the side too much. Sure, the heated water that comes out of these things in Long Island, it was kind of funny because we had a nuclear power plant, and we would always fish there on Long Island. It was in Northport. We would try to get, there would be fish, the tropical fish would be in this stream of warm water. They would actually somehow, through warmer season stay in New York at this area, we'd actually have tropical type fish, which is really unique, and everybody would make the trek out to Northport to try to fish there. The fun part about what I've noticed about the heating, it's on such massive scales, and yes, these big corporations. Now you wonder to yourself, why can't there be regulation? Okay, let's check out regulatory commissions. So you have regulatory. Did I spell? Jesus Christ. Regulatory commissions in Florida. Okay. Now, oops. Let's see. Yeah, I can't spell this, but save my life. So yeah, there are so many different state agencies right here that it's ridiculous to think that we should have any type of problem with, look at all of them, with all of the different municipalities. You would think something here would have benefit, but of course, you know, when you get your Florida fishing license, nobody's giving you any lessons on the fish. You just pay money. You just pay money to go fish. And fish for what? There's nothing left. There's no fish. Because as you said, Tammy, the biodiversity thing. There's another thing that's happening in Florida also. Of course, we have exotic species and such like that, like they want to say, like the snakehead. That's just part of natural ecology and natural evolution, that a new species comes in. It'll change the face. That's a paradigm, basically, right there. That's a shift. That's a revolutionary creature coming in to disseminate what was there prior, and it'll start a new environment there. A new habitat will form. So don't fret when you see things like snakehead and stuff. That's not going to, it'll change things, sure. And sadly, yes, of course, for some of us, we like our bass and we like our certain things. But it's interesting that these things come in and we fight them off with sticks. And it's part of the natural evolution. Even if a human brought it there, we're natural creatures. Now, in a post-natural society, all of this, this stuff in front of us, this ecosystem, is all an art project, all to be managed by a group. And then that becomes the paradigm shift, which becomes normal science. So the idea that these people are putting things in the ocean, right, for creating a cooler Earth, when the things that they're doing aren't stopping the cooling of, aren't helping a cooling Earth, right? So they're not stopping the emissions. They're not cutting anything from these factories. They're just taxing them. It's all about money. Has nothing, and that down the road is the carrot on the end of the stick, which leads scientists to do what they do. Otherwise, they wouldn't do it. You know, you wouldn't be able to get some kind of some skeevy guy from underneath or whomever underneath the rock to come out and say, "Hey, we need you to kind of play a game. We need you to work with us." You know, and somebody who's desperate enough will take it in a heartbeat. Hey, I might even, if you give me enough money, who knows what I'll do? I don't know yet. No one's ever offered me $2 million, $3 million, $10, $15 million. I might turn coat in a second. Next thing I'd be like Dr. Evil, bald head and all. I don't want to do that. You know what I'm saying? Maybe that's why I never won Lotto. I don't know. I'm glad. I'd rather have an Earth that I could actually spend that money in. Because what's happening is in the paradigm cycle, in the scientific revolution, all of our stuff could be destroyed, including the people, every animal. It doesn't matter to them. Their main concern is getting ahead of the game, and the game is so fast paced that when you see what many, I don't want to go look for it right now, but there's a video where you see that all of the people talking about the 5G, the people in the FCC have no idea. They say outwardly, "We don't know what it's about, but we need to push it." Tom Wheeler said, "Oh, it's damn important to push 5G. That's part of paradigm science. They don't care if we fry from it. They do. That's not what their concern is. Their concern is to their concern is to shift everything. It's so deep and so much more than just we need." Why are they focusing our attention with our perceptions towards businesses? Why are we being focused towards sugar? Prime example, Agenda 21, or let's get away from Agenda 21. Let's go to our friends Monsanto. They have a thing called stevia, okay? Stevia has been extremely popularized, and it's a plant that comes from Paraguay. I think it's like wiki wiki waka plant or something. Comes from Paraguay, and it's used as a sweetener. Of course, they also use sugar cane. So they don't use this plant as much. This plant has been linked to cancer, but apparently since the 90s, under the Freedom of Information Act, or because even with the Freedom of Information Act, that information has been missing. We can't get those medical records or anything about stevia causing cancer. And now all you'll find on the web is positive things about it shrinking tumors. I don't believe anything I read on Google per se, because Google itself is literally the monster that's running the show. But also within our monster that's running the show, within the deception are truths. So here, you want to see something funny? Watch. Here. Solar. Now, if you're in Florida, you know all about chemtrails. You do. You do know about it because you see these planes flying through the sky. And you feel the humidity. Oh my God, I can't spell. Solar radiation management. I want to show you something. When you tell me, when people want to tell me that there's no such thing as chemtrails, I direct them over here. I'm not laughing because it's funny. It drives me insane that people could be so abrasive and not even do the research. Solar radiation management is the chemtrail stuff. You get it? This is a Harvard thing. They have governances now. They don't call government anymore. You get it? We're not in a local government municipality world. You'll hear all of your government officials say, we have no more power or jurisdiction over this stuff, so we can't stop them from spraying the skies. Which is, and that's part of the revolution, scientific revolution, is that, oh yeah, some of you are going to die from this. A few million, easy, going to die. Right now, they already say that a million people die from air pollution, but they don't tell you from what. And I can tell you from what. I can tell you exactly from what, because I've done the research, and I don't want to dig it up right now because I'm running out of time. I want to keep this under an hour. But the point is that the solar radiation management is that chemtrail stuff you see, which is a multifoliate experience happening. They're doing things like blocking 30% of the sun. I'm going to show you. Harvard boasts. It's one of those things. It's one of those things until you actually see it, you don't believe it. Boasts 30% solar radiation reduction. Oh God, I can't. Reduction. Harvard Solar Geoengineering Program. How artificially brightened clouds, mysterious flashes could be spacecrafts at work. Harvard, blah blah blah. By the way, or building a green way. Building a green way. Harvard Business Review. You see, folks, you really dig into the Harvard papers, you're going to start finding out what these reasons are for, why they're disseminating your environment, why all the snook are going to be dead, why all the green algae, why all the red tide, why all the corruption. It's all about one carrot, one dude with a carrot, right? And he's leading a horse along. He's hiding in the bushes, and he's pulling that carrot along. Or it's like a dog race where that rabbit runs around and all the dogs go chasing it. This is what they do. They have specifically and eugenically, genetically, figured out who a prime candidate would be for these jobs. Now, I want to show you something. Harvard boasts 30% solar radiation reduction. What do you see as pictures? Solar panels. If you have purchased a solar panel, what you gonna do with it when they're actually blocking out the sun? And if you look at some of their videos, you'll see. I've been studying solar radiation management for a little over 3 or 4 years now. I've watched it, and I've watched it during hurricanes down here, or so-called hurricanes. I know all about weather management. I've been studying meteorology as a kid and in college, and I studied it as an adult, and I know what it's all about. And these effers are messing with us really bad. So what's happening is they want you to change everything to solar panels on your house under the auspice you're going to save money. But when they're blocking out the sun at the same time, it's just they're not telling you because they use big scientific funky words that don't sound like what you'd normally use as as language. Like, you know, when you hear everybody saying one thing and you start using it, look, if I go to search chemtrails, look what happens. Well, you know, this is what you see. Of course, it's all real. And, you know, here's one that's real funny. You know, isn't that nice? Really, aren't they funny? I hate that debunking word. Oh, God. Anyway, they're real. It's real. It's a lot more than chems. It's metals. It's salt. It's diamonds. It's all kinds of stuff. It's tons of stuff up there. They're spraying lots and lots of stuff, either through laced fuels or they actually have injectors that inject the stuff. Yes, they do. And I can discern from the difference. There's stuff for the air shows. That's called a smoke oil. It's a paraffin wax oil that they spray onto the actual motor, which makes a gas come out and looks really cool even at slow speeds, you know, because the condensate would only happen at a high altitude above 40 or 35,000 feet at least, and that's all you'll see is that tiny section of puff, and it disappears within 5 or 10 seconds. That's when they're crossing that zone of very cold air, which is at actually the lower part of the stratosphere. The higher part of the stratosphere you think would be cooler is actually warmer. Isn't that weird? So the higher part of the stratosphere is warmer, and the lower part's cooler, and that's why you see even on the jets now with their high efficiency motors that do not put off any kind of discernible exhaust, because they recirculate the exhaust for higher efficiency. They get more thrust by recirculating it. So the idea is that, yeah, sure, they leave a tiny, tiny contrail, but that's only at about 40 to 35,000 feet when they reach climbing altitude. You'll see them climb, boom, it stops when they hit a certain spot. Anyway, that's not the topic, but that's part of this. So you have David Keith here, who's in charge of carbon capture companies. David Keith owns Keith Industries. Keith. Dr. David Keith. I'm going to show you this one last thing, and this is why we're having a problem here with our CO2, why we're having a problem in Florida with the ecosystem. This guy right here, I want you to do yourself a favor and do some research on him. He has a carbon capture. Look at this creepy. This guy's got a carbon capture company, and basically he is the one in charge of those chemtrails up there and all that geoengineering stuff. And he really is. He's a real person. He really works for Harvard. He talks about spraying the skies. He was on the Colbert Report. They even talked about the blocking out the sun on the Ellen show. It's not a mystery. It's all real stuff. But this son of a bitch here has I don't want to mean to curse, but this guy has these things called carbon captures, and he's going to take your carbon for you and charge you to store it. But you're not putting on, you're breathing. You're not doing anything wrong, but you're going to be carbon taxed for everything you've done through an austerity movement. You might not be taking money from your pocket, you're taking everything else. You're not going to have what you had. It's a freaky thing these people are doing. And it's real. So when we look at what's happening in Florida's ecosystem, remember, they're trying to shut down big industry. I'm gonna encapsulate this whole entire speech and try it right now. They're doing in Florida something called demodeling of the state, okay? Because they need to make it into something. First of all, they need to get people here. How are they doing it? They're building everywhere. They're taking out every bit of tree, every bit of property, every bit of green and plant. And what they're doing is they're building a I'm going to do some questions after this, so that I'll leave room for some questions too, so I can answer anything. So what happens is they're doing this unique thing I get wordy sometimes, but there's a lot to cover in a short period of time, and I hope I try to get around it all. So they have ways of taking your algae, right, and to turn it into fuel. So the new fuel of the future for sustainability is biofuel, and it's made from algae. You could grow algae in the desert. It doesn't need to be in the ocean, but the ocean is cheaper. It's cheaper to do it in the ocean. And so that's what they're doing. So the part of this multi-phase thing is there's people making money from fuel. That's this guy's motivation for wanting to be part of this situation, is he's going to make a fortune from his discovery of biology fuel in 1 year rather than a million years. Next, we have the Copernicus thing as opposed to Ptolemy, whereas all of the truths of before are gone. all the truth under what Kuhn is talking about. When you change a paradigm, for example, Newtonian and Einsteinian physics, they're two different worlds. And a conversation between those two people, and I'm paraphrasing, it would be like one talking past the other. They wouldn't even understand what they meant. The atomists from the ancient Greeks and the people who study atoms now under an electron microscope would have two very different views of what an atom is. But the atomists of ancient Greece believed in atoms. And this was well before any kind of real science was made. These people believed in atoms. So interestingly enough, the concepts of our truths, our universal truths, are not universal. The only universal truths we have is, hey, I meet you, I shake your hand, hey, nice to meet you. That's a truth. We shared. We saw a sunrise. We saw a sunset. We shared. We saw a fish that I didn't lie about catching. We shared that moment. I was this big, I swear. We shared that moment. You know, that's a universal truth we can agree upon. But when it comes to these bigger truths, they change. Sons of bees change our truths. And so, like, our history, as according to MIT, much of our histories have been altered or fuddled with on purpose to see what the reactionary responses would be and to help formulate new societal means, new societies, new societal paradigm. I hate you overusing the word, but paradigm, the way of life, the way of things. The way that we do things is the paradigm. Our language is it also. So with all of our little Florida departments, they mean nothing because they don't have jurisdiction over the bigger things like geoengineering, over the bigger things like building. These people could tell where the builders will go build, but they're making money. They want the money. So, you know, lower guy over here, I'm not saying lower guy, I'm saying lower scientific community, being, let's say, a community of like the department of a building department, right? That's a scientific community, but it's not like, let's say, nuclear science. It's the science of building and the science of zoning. You know, I would never put anybody down, whatever department they're in. That the idea is that's a different part of science. I don't want to say lower meaning less, but if there is less involvement of than nuclear physics, okay? Let's put it that way. So on a scale, this scientific group, like the Highway Patrol, uses the science of human weakness. They use the science of how to manipulate human weakness. And I don't want to put any cops down, but, you know, we know what the job is of law enforcement. Law cannot be law without an enforcement. You can't have laws, and laws are made to control. And it's all just basic black and white. Laws control. You can't have society or civilization without laws. And you can't have laws without police or a force. Even one guy with a stick. So knowing that none of these people that have any jurisdiction over the environment, they have only jurisdiction over people, we've eliminated those people, okay? So we got rid of them. We got rid of Nicola Copernicus. We understand that there's a shift going on in society. There's a shift in fuel. There's a shift in all of our sustainability. There's a Florida process happening now where Florida is becoming overgrown. You would think to yourself you would want there to be more trees. That they're a very efficient CO2 capturer and gas exchanger, but they're not efficient for money making. This guy can't make money off a tree, so he's putting in plastic trees. I'll show you this real quick. This is so interesting. I hate to stop. Plastic trees. Oh no, this is for CO2 absorption. Look, they even give me it. Look at this. Look at this. It's there in black and white. There's no conspiracies. They're taking down all the trees, folks. And the reason being is they have these artificial trees that do whatever they're doing. And you see behind that sky filled with all kinds of gobbledygook from geoengineering. All that wispy, it's all geoengineering. Oh, they're horrible the way they image this stuff. Anyway, so, so brutal. So here's some more plastic trees. That's not a tree, folks. It's Star Trek is what that is. Here's some of the plastic trees that look at that thing. You want that? I don't want that. Do you see any trees in that cityscape except for those? No. And what the problem is that with Mars on the horizon, they're using Earth. They're using Earth as a testing ground for, what you call it? For, what's the word? Oh my God. Transmutating Mars. oxygenating it. Oh, God. Terraforming, sorry. Terraforming Mars. Don't believe me? Watch. Terraforming Mars. Now, terraforming Mars is look, there's games to program the kids. There's how long will it take to... They have things for terraforming Mars between board games, books, Mars Needs Women, Mars Needs Moms, Mars Needs, Mars Needs, Mars Needs, right? Now, if you look at terraforming Mars and we go to, let's see, AT&T, watch this. This will make your pucker. Make your butt pucker. Tame the Red Planet Android Police, the latest board game. Terraforming Mars, Asmodee model. See, this is the corporate... Okay, here we go. Here's... Okay. So now, this is basically a game to teach you how to do it. So they get people on board. I'm trying to find something of a... You can look it up. If you here. Watch this. Watch. Forget this. I forgot. TED Talks. Come on. Uh-oh. Something's going on. Oh, you know what it is? I'm having my computer does some funny stuff. Okay, so here. TED Talks. Come on, man. Now, this guy, you can watch this on at your own rate. This guy right here. Ted is a very good nudger, a very good get you ready for what's coming unit. And this guy right here, and I don't want to get hit with any kind of copyrights or anything like that. But of course, and also my computer is too bogged down with all the windows open. But you can watch this on YouTube and wherever else you can find it. But your kids might live on Mars and how they might survive, and they talk all about it. It's in the works. They have paradigms set up now to crush the entire ecosystem that we live in, and it won't matter. They don't care about how many we are. They have automated systems now. They have people that can live outside of the zone of 5G. People will be living outside of certain areas, but they'll be science people. You've got to work for the state, for the city, otherwise, or the state, the system, otherwise you won't be able to get the benefits. That's what they're trying to push people to do. And I want to thank you for listening. It's an hour. I don't want to run too deep. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. I don't know if I even covered everything. I don't know where the heck my screen is. I'm trying to find my Facebook screen. I know. There it is. Here it is. Hold on. I want to see if anybody's is still there. Tammy, you're still here. Cool. Okay. I don't know if I answered your questions, Tammy. I'm going to wait till the 30-second, what do you call it, goes through so you can... tell me if I answered anything, or if I didn't answer anything, or if you had another question that maybe I can answer. But what I've been seeing is I have been seeing a change in our environment. There is definitely a global warming experience happening, but it might not be anything that's not supposed to happen. It might be part of a natural cycle, and they're disguising it as part of an industry thing to create the new system for the UN's 21st Agenda Sustainability Movement. So there's so much going on, and if I have a whiteboard, I'd be better off. I need like a chalkboard because it's like really, it's so intertwined, and all of these people are players in a bigger game. The bottom line is they're using the idea that we need a better science to create anything that they want to with any repercussions that follow. And generally, most of them don't know the repercussions. They're just kind of going along with the game because they're having fun. And not everybody's involved. You see, only me and you are watching this. Only two people, me and you. That's it. And that's biofuel production. There's so much. If you look up and you go digging into biofuel, you'll see why they're getting rid of the industries like oil. 100 years ago, they talked about Bertrand Russell, all of the eugenicist people, all the elite guys, like one of my favorite people is Aldous Huxley. One of my best professors I've ever had was Aldous Huxley. He's very different. He's the black sheep in his family. He's the one who dropped acid and ate mushrooms, and he's the one who tried to warn us. He was actually George Orwell's French teacher, Aldous was. So that's kind of fun to think that Aldous Huxley was a linguist professor to Orwell, who everybody's focused on Orwell's life. Orwell told 1984 based on his real experience with it. It wasn't fake. What he was doing is a projection of 50 years, which is why it was 1984. He wrote it in 1934. So because he wrote it in 34, he wanted a 50-year projection of the future, and that's how it would be. This one saw it, yes, this one saw it, no. Come on now, move along. I got that stuck in my head. That's the cafeteria scenes. You should watch the BBC 84. I've shown it on here. It's very insightful. But what happens is in the Brave New World is everything is synthetic. And 100 years ago, the archetype of the modern technocrat was talking. And I'll tell you, Lord Birkenhead was specifically in a Cosmopolitan interview, and I have it written down. I have the actual hard copy if you want it. I can give you a print of it or something, or I'll give you the download. They might have taken it off the web because it was really crucial stuff. But 100 years ago, he gave an article to Cosmopolitan where he talked about the things coming in the future, and one of those things he was talking about were the days being 48 hours long, no more work, you'd be a socialist. He was talking about the 21st century as different types of energies and things like that, and controlling weather, controlling all the stuff that we're doing today. He also talked about wireless, mass communication through basic internet is what he was talking about. Yeah, it was really cool. And so, yeah, this is 100 years ago. I mean, the guy was digging into it. And if you look up Cosmopolitan interview, Lord Birkenhead, and so these early technocrats had plans for this stuff. It was never mystery. It was always part of the game. And we're all just kind of like being used to build the automation for them. Literally, this is the most ancient agenda. It's not supernatural. This is what we used to laugh at in school when we used to hear about the kings and queens making an entire nation bow down before them and like eat dirt, and like, you know, oh, we will never do that to ourselves. Bullshit, we're doing it to ourselves now. We've cornered ourselves, we painted ourselves in the corner, and they know this up top. So what they did, Marx explained to the early economists of the world that were going to build America, the New Atlantis, which was what they called America, the New Atlantis. They were going to build America in this image of capitalism so that America could be the industry port for the world to build for. Guess why? We had all, it was a free land of what you call building supplies. Because they knew back then when they formed America how to mine. They knew how to get the things from the earth they needed. And they knew America was rich. So they came to America under the guise of colonization to flee taxes just to take over. And I'm talking, the only one who didn't want this was Adam Weishaupt, who everybody thinks is like, who doesn't know, people don't really know who he is. He's the founder of the Illuminati, basically. Well, not so much a founder, but one of the founding fathers. And people think the Illuminati is the devil and stuff. But no, it was vilified by the church as a demonic organization, so people wouldn't pay attention to it. Now, the church worked through a lot of people who were in the Mason community, right? The Freemasons. And Adam Weishaupt said, we can't give the basic principle as to why we're here in this country to the Freemason or the other secret societies because they have loose lips and they talk too much. This is some good reading from his stuff. So when they came to this country, there was a conflict. So literally there is up way up high in the elite little land of wherever they go to eat their lobster, Thermidor. They have their own black and white. They have their own war going on over good and evil. But they're, of course, their ethics are very different than ours. They've never walked a minute in our shoes. But Aldous Huxley has. The man dropped acid. He tripped out. He was like Mr. Psychedelic. And he's the one who gave us Jim Morrison and the Doors. Without Aldous Huxley and his book, The Doors of Perception, the Doors might have been called the, I don't know, the really bad singer. The really bad sounding guy who would scream. That guy screaming would have been the name of the Doors. That guy screaming, dancing like a lunatic. So, you know, Jim Morrison was a big Aldous fan. He read a lot of Jimbo. So, you know, his stuff sounds so foreign, but he was doing poetry based on some early readings and stuff. So that's why it sounds so foreign. Not to get off topic, but there is deeper roots is what I'm trying to portray here, that there's deeper roots in this whole system than just what we see as the norm through society. And Facebook will feed us so much crap because Facebook's part of the news. They're part of perception management. And perception management is what's going to get us all in the room throwing darts at a dartboard in the dark. after a couple six packs. Let's go, guys. Everybody in the room. Sounds like a great idea. Let's go play darts in the dark. It's going to be fun. I promise. Everybody go ahead and throw. Yeah, I'm sure it's a great idea. That's paradigm science, throwing darts in the dark. And we are in the paradigm shift. We're here. And it's one of those things where I don't know. There's nothing we can actually kind of do. We can only just kind of ride it. But it's just, it's kind of like Brave New World meets Road Warrior. I don't know what else to say. So yeah, we're going through climate crisis. One last thing I'm going to show you because this is so important, and I just want you to check this out. This is a very good. This is a very good thing right here. This is the UN, United Nations. Club of Rome. Hold on. It should be saved in my thing. Club of Rome. Climate. Club of Rome. Hold on. I'm sorry. There we go. Okay. We'll fit the bill here. Climate. Now, I'm going to show you a quote from the Club of Rome. Now, if you don't know who Club of Rome is, they are the premier think tank for, this is, first of all, climatism.blog. Excellent, excellent website. Climate fraud to alarmism, Agenda 21, everything you need to know and all of it sourced. Nothing of it is bullshit. It's absolutely amazing. This is somebody who really took time to do this, okay? I'm going to show you the one thing. I'll give you a pause. In searching for a new enemy to unite us, we came up with the idea that the threat of global warming would fit the bill. The real enemy then is humanity itself. Now, of course, that's chopped. I'm going to take you to the bigger quote down below. Think about that for 1 second. Man itself is the enemy. Maurice Strong, very, very rich man who died recently, is a suit he made so much money off of all of the problems the Earth has. But here he is saying, it isn't the hope, isn't the only hope for the planet that the industrial civilizations collapse? So there we go with what's happening in Florida. We're going to blame sugar. Got to get rid of industry. Industry. We got to get rid of industry in our civilizations. Sorry. Industry is important to collapse for the agenda's plan. Maurice Strong is the founder of the UN Environmental Program. There you go. From the mouth of the horse itself. Isn't it the only hope for the planet that the industrialized civilizations collapse? America's going down, folks. We're going third world. Isn't it our responsibility to bring it about? Oh, boy. Thank you. Current lifestyles and consumption patterns of the affluent middle class. See, the rich are going to feel this one, folks. Involving high meat intake. Use of fossil fuels, appliances, air conditioning, and suburban housing are not sustainable. This is the man with all the influence, folks. I'm trying to step back from the mic so I'm not yelling. This is the man with all the influence. This guy, Maurice Strong, who's dead, but left his legacy behind. It's the responsibility of each human being today to choose between the force of darkness and the force of light. Ooh, it's Star Wars. We must therefore transform our attitudes and adopt a renewed respect for the superior laws of divine nature. I snorted. Divine nature, they're using nature as a new god, you get it? So of course I love nature, but didn't something create nature? Maybe there's a god that created it? We're like, nah, we don't need that. I personally, it's not for me to say whether there is or not a god or whatever you believe, but the idea is that he's just saying, no, earth is your god now. Suffer unto your lord. Everybody bow before the trees, which are going to be cut out. So yeah, this website when you get a chance. It is definitely one you get lost in. This climatism, this is the real thing. These things are put here for people who are actually involved in, like, really wanted to. Okay, I'm going to give you the link right now. Let's see. And believe me, it gets deeper, Tammy. Oops. Let me back it up. I hear myself. Hold on. Let me back it up. Back it up. I have so many windows going on. Here you go, Tammy. I dropped it in there for you. Doink. Okay. Yeah, climatism is great. Yeah, and so yeah, they divert us from the truth. They give us so much crap and so much confusion and so many things to make us wonder. And really, in the essence of it all of the whatchacallit is basically is a creation. It's a creation of policies. And you know how the UN works. I mean, and if you look around and you see that every single bit of it is falling like a domino. But see, it takes time. You have to kind of like pick and choose and pick through it. You got to take a few minutes here and there and read it, and then you'd be like, oh well, I see that happening here, or I see that there, and you'd be like, oh, holy crap, this is unreal. So but what it does is it takes away the fear, and it puts into a perspective that these people are doing this under the we know what they're doing. We know now for real. We know they're crummy people who are not the good scientists. They're not the good people. So there are still good people out there. That's what we need to remember. There's still good people. And I'm gonna drop this now. I see the time is getting close to like 1 minute and 15 here, so I don't want to go too far over, because I don't think anybody would ever watch. But I'm glad you did, Tammy, and I'm glad I could be of some enlightenment. Dig back on some of my other videos on Outside the Box. I mean, you might find something that's that drives a little spark to look in the different direction. But because here's a fun one, one last one. This one, I can't look. I can't stop. But this only takes 2 seconds. Hold on, you'll like this. Dickens, here. Dickens fight. I think it's already in my thing. Here, you can check this out. I'll put this here. How Charles Dickens helped the English get fresh air tax. They used to block their windows out because they were being taxed for fresh air. So Charles Dickens helped this. He is an artist. You see how the artists, when they mix with society, they can help people. Charles Dickens is best known for his sagas and of poverty and beauty in London. So now, but Dickens time in Dickens time, people had to pay for the privilege of having light and air in their homes. Thanks for the new law designed to turn England's buildings into revenue streams, between 16 and 1800s, Britain's Parliament put a premium on windows, shaping the architecture of the day and even endangering lives. So just so you know that this is very, very real. People, those people who did that then are still in charge. They just laid low for a little while. They were just like, yo, laying low, you know? but okay, I'm glad, Tammy, thank you so much for joining me. I'm gonna split so I don't like overdo this, and I'm glad I can open up some windows and some windows for the fresh air tax. I'll go ahead and I'll put this in there, because this one even like grandma and grandpa know, you know what I'm saying? Like, they know who Charles Dickens is, and it puts in perspective who's in charge of the world and what they do with us, and that they never left their throne. They just kind of went on vacation. They had enough money to lay low, go on sabbatical. Anyway, Tommy, thank you so much for joining me. Everybody, thank you out there. Peace. Have a very nice day, and I will talk to you a little bit later. Tammy, thank you for buying soap. I appreciate it. I'm gonna send you some extras in the mail too, in there, some cool stuff with you. I really appreciate the kindness and your ear and your friendship. Nice to meet you and be with you in this world. And have a great day, and I wish you all the best. Okay. Peace. Julie, nice to see you. I'm just leaving, but you watch this and you can rewind it, and I'll talk to you all later. I love you, folks.